Eats. I'm Diane Hatz. I am your host, and I'm very pleased to welcome our guest for today, Wen-Jay Ying. Wen-Jay Ying is the owner and founder of Local Roots NYC, a minority female-owned small business that connects New Yorkers with local farmers and sustainable purveyors. Wen-Jay started the company at age 26 and was awarded Entrepreneur of the Year by New York City Mayor Bloomberg. She is an alumni of the Good Work Institute, is a contributing editor to Potluck Journal, and has a weekly radio show called Food Stripped Naked. I don't know how you have time to do what you do, Wen-Jay. Today, you'll find her female-led team distributing over 60,000 pounds of sustainable produce a year, connecting 1,500-plus New York households with freshly harvested and nutrient-dense food sourced from over 15 family farms and 20-plus small batch purveyors. Welcome, Wen-Jay. How are you? Oh, unmute yourself.
Don't confuse me.
Well, you came on early anyway.
I know. I like to be prepared. You want to see my lunch?
Sorry?
You want to see my lunch?
Are you eating raw corn?
Yeah. You know, because no one ever thinks to eat corn raw, and I don't know why they cook it.
I have to tell you, Wen-Jay, I was in Portland on a farm and they let us go in the field and take a stalk and eat it raw. It was one of the best things I've ever eaten in my life.
It's juicier.
Amazing.
I think there's something about, like, when you cook it, I think it takes away the flavor, I think.
I do. I don't know. Maybe if people are scared of bugs or I don't know.
But anyway,
but how are you in these COVID days?
Well, it's like, how long of an answer do you want? No, I'm good. I feel like I'm really lucky and honored to, every day I'm like, I'm so lucky to have a business that is deemed essential. And we've been working throughout the whole pandemic and we're still working. And that feels really good, especially I have a lot of friends who also have small businesses that haven't, you know, that have either like reduced their operations or haven't been operating. So I know how lucky we really are, which is great.
So explain what Local Roots is to people who might not know. Like, it seems to be more than just a food delivery service. So explain to people exactly who you are and what you do.
Cool. So Local Roots has been around since 2011, and we are a subscription-based farmers market, also known as a modernized CSA for all you local foodies out there. And if you pre-order local sustainably grown produce from us, we do produce, meat, dairy, grains. We even do condiments that are made locally, pastas. And you pre-order that on our website, and then you can opt to pick it up at one of our locations, or you get it delivered. And our locations are essentially like pop-up markets. They're at bars or cafes. And obviously right now we are offering contactless delivery. And also we have our pickup markets are very, very COVID safe. You put your bag on a table, we put your food in the bag. Everyone's wearing masks, everyone's socially distancing. So you don't have like a million people just touching food that you're also gonna bring home, which I think is the scary thing about grocery stores. We also do lots of recipes. We really believe in providing like fun education around how to cook, but then also like the truth about why local food is so good and the truths about industrial agriculture, because we want to make a really big difference in the food system. And we can only do that with the real knowledge about what is so broken. So that's what we really focus on.
So you're Local Roots NYC, so one can assume you're New York City, but what is your sort of your area? I mean, you not just have people you deliver to, you have farms you work with. So what's basically the area you work in?
Yeah, so the farms, we like to define local as within 2 hours of New York City. I think defining local is really important because the word local is a very generic term. There's no government entity really like regulating that. So anyone can say anything's local. And we really push people to avoid greenwashing. So we work with farms in upstate New York, Pennsylvania, Long Island, and we deliver to customers in Brooklyn, Manhattan, Queens.
So, okay, this is the most important question of the day. I don't know if you know, but I worked in the music industry many years ago. Why were you backstage? Why were you backstage at the, and I saw that you play instruments and were in bands, but why were you backstage at the Flaming Lips? And what advice did the lead singer give you?
Leanne, why would you not be backstage at the Playmate concert?
Okay, how did you get backstage?
I know that if you were there, you'd also be backstage hanging out with the band, just like me.
Of course I did.
It was honestly, I love that band. They had the best show. And I have always wanted, they always have like, you know, people from the audience dancing on stage. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to dance on stage. So I went to go see them in Philadelphia and I was like, you know what? Today is the day we're gonna fucking go on stage. So I like waited to see where like their band crew was like entering the stage. And I asked them and he was like, okay, if you stay over here, just be really enthusiastic, we'll pick you. So they chose us and I got to wear like a pink Power Ranger outfit, a costume. And you dance on stage with the band the entire time. It was incredible. Afterwards, you hang out with the band after, like behind stage, backstage, also known as backstage. And I just started talking to Wayne, like the main singer, and he was like, what do you want to do with your life? I think I was probably like 23 or something at the time. And I was just telling him, like, I feel really compelled to help other people. You know, like I had at the time really wanted to work for a nonprofit that would help with affordable housing. Or it was the same time when Hurricane Katrina really had destroyed New Orleans. So I was thinking about moving down to New Orleans. And his response was like, you know, I think that's great. You want to help your community, but a lot of times people forget that your direct neighborhood might need your help. And you don't have to always just jump around to like natural disaster to natural disaster to help out. So maybe just think about what your neighborhood needs. And that was really the pivotal moment in my life where I thought about what it means to be local with the place and the people around you. And realizing that everyone's needs are so specific based on your region and how important and impactful all those local changes are, which is why I love local food. You know, it's like it, to me, it feels like I can make the biggest positive impact in the world and the most tangible impact in the world by bringing like a different food option to New York City. Otherwise it's like before, you know, like, when I first started in 2011, the other options were like, yeah, there were farmers markets, there were CSAs, but it wasn't as accessible to most people.
Yeah.
And especially as someone who was like 23, it didn't feel like that was like my crowd. You know, it wasn't like a hip thing. It wasn't like, it just wasn't a scene.
It's all old people, Wen-Jay, just say it. All old people at the farmers market.
Well, you know why? Because the CSA that I joined, it was, the picket was in a church, you know, and I just never felt, it's not that I don't believe in going to a church, it's more that it's so quiet, it's so sterile.
Right.
And I really love the idea of CSAs bringing people together, and I wanted to like meet people and talk to people, you know, and I felt like I couldn't do that inside of a religious institution. Right. So, yeah.
So, you wrote somewhere that you think small businesses can change the world.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Because we can, and Local Roots is.
give me your philosophy behind it.
I think that because small businesses, one, as we can see through COVID, what happened to to industrial agriculture is that they couldn't really pivot and evolve as quickly. And all those cracks of industrial agriculture really showed. Whereas you look at the small farms, they could evolve their operations overnight because they had to. And that's why they really thrive. Same with us. You know, like we evolved our business and operations within 48 hours, which is the only reason why we could keep operating. So one, the fact that we're so small, like small businesses are able to like be, they can just tweak what they do a lot quicker. They don't have management to talk to. It's just us, you know. I think also as a small business, because you have such a tight relationship and close relationship with your customers, if you really listen to them, you can really listen to what their needs are and just create a more personalized and better service for them, which they'll appreciate. And you can, I think it's easier to convey a value system in that way too. Mm. For me, it's like, because we're trying to convey so much information to our customers about how our farmers grow, I think they're more open to listening to us because, for example, like they recognize my face, you know, it's like I'm the founder, they see me often, and they want to hear what I want to say. And they know what we represent so much. that they're interested to hear what we had to say, because it resonates also with like some curiosity they also have. I also just think like we, for, like a business like ours, because we don't have investors, we don't have to do things or take actions just based on what an investor tells us or just returning a profit. We're able to really focus on like certain values that might mean more to us than just making money, which is why I think we can have a bigger impact beyond just like,
monetary. Isn't that refreshing though? Not having investors that, I mean, it's the same because, you know, it's a nonprofit. I can have funders and they sort of telling you what to do. And it's like, oh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I also can say that after 9 years and now that I'm in the level of like trying to really make my business successful, the more expenses that you have, like the bigger you grow, it's not like you make more money, you know, you just have like more expenses.
Right.
So I totally understand why some people opt to get investors, but I also love the fucking fact that like I 100% own my company. And it also just means that like the work culture we have is something that just comes naturally to us. So it feels like a family. It doesn't feel corporate. We can make our own decisions. We can, yeah.
But you said that the bigger you grow, you don't necessarily make more money. Because I have this whole thing, like, why does everyone have to get bigger? We don't have to get bigger. We don't have to merge.
Yeah.
Like,
no, it's interesting. Like, I probably made more money my first year than I do now. If that's what your measure of success is, you know?
Well, how do you measure success?
For me, it's like really taking care of my employees. That really means a lot to me. So like if we could provide all the benefits that like the biggest companies do for our employees, I'd be so happy. To us, it's also about like, can we be supporting more local farmers without ever feeling nervous? Like, I want to make sure that we have a guaranteed customer base for them all the time so they feel comfortable that they have a job and a livelihood that's also supported financially for a long time. That to me is success. And I think being able to like, I mean, I have so many ideas and visions and dreams of how we could change the food system, and just being able to implement all those ideas and execute them is success to me, you know, no matter if it brings in a lot of money. It's just the fact that this is something I really believe should be in the world, and to be able to bring that to the world, it, to me, is great.
Okay, so you have to tell me at least one of your visions and ideas. You opened that door, so, huh? Sorry?
It's a secret. No, I'll tell you. Well, I can tell you that a couple big things are going to happen in the next month and a half that people want to just keep following us.
Oh, that's not. Come on. Okay, Wen-Jay. Well, you could give a vision. It doesn't have to be something you're actually doing.
Yeah, okay. Like, so we're, okay, no. Okay, I'll play your game. Well, I definitely think that, okay, this is pretty general, but I think right now local food still is not that accessible, you know?
Ugh, you're so right, yes.
Yeah, so like I think the problem in the food system for what we do in our industry is it's always been like, well, this is the way it is. So the customer has to meet us where we are. And I've felt like that for a long time just because, like, you know, me and you, like if you work in the industry, you know all the nuances of why providing local good food is so hard to do operationally, logistics, all those things. Like to be able to do it, having strong values, it's very hard, you know?
Right.
But I want to make sure we have ways to meet the customer closer to where they are, because we can't expect customers to change their lifestyle just to fit into what was once done with local food.
Right.
So it's just keeping that philosophy in mind with the ways that we approach what we do in the future is really important. It's kind of in the same philosophy as, I bring this up a lot when I'm with you, but one time that you were moderating a panel at Hunter College that I was on, It was Food is Medicine, and your closing statement was like, why are we all talking about this in the same room with other people that believe the same thing? You know, like go out and tell other people. And that's how I feel about it too. It's like, Yeah, like we could be serving the same consumers who are already interested in this, and that's really awesome. But to really make a huge difference, we're not going to serve everyone, you know, like we're not going to meet the needs of everyone's diets and everyone's lifestyles. But if we can make what we do a lot more accessible, then we can make a bigger difference.
Well, do you know what I'm working on now? Planning chair. I haven't seen you in a while.
You know what, Diane? I really have no idea what you're working on. I'm so confused.
A lot of people are. So I've lost you. I can't see
you. I know. Hold on. Sorry. I'm sorry. Someone's delivering something to me and they're confused where they're going.
Okay. So
I can hear you though.
Okay. I'm going to tell you while you're not on the screen. So we recently launched, and it's still in the beginning stages, a program called Plan 8 Chair, because I believe that everybody has the right to healthy food. So what I've noticed over the past year or so are that communities around the world are doing these different projects to plant food in public spaces for people to eat for free. Like Grace Church, I thought it was Cooper Union or NYU, but it's Grace Church, which is a church up on Broadway, so in Greenwich Village. They've planted a farm right at Astor Place. They have vegetables, they have tomatoes, they have zucchini, they have all these, and they've just planted it. And like that, there's a farm on top of Cooper Union. So even in New York City, which is probably the most cement-laden, you know, populated area, there are people doing this. Now, will this feed everyone everything? No, but you know, Steve Ritz has his farm up in the Bronx and they grow so much food. And my belief is that communities know the answers to their problems and that all they need is help, advice, but they can come up with what's best for them. So, so like Denmark, Copenhagen just passed a law less than a year ago. They're planting berry bushes in all the public parks. Like, why don't we do that? And then food, have you heard of food forests? Like Atlanta has a 7-acre food forest. So you grow like nut trees, berries, then down to like strawberries. So you grow all different types of foods. And the way it's done is permaculture. It takes care of itself. So you don't have to water or tend it. People just come in and harvest what they want to eat. I think that's the way to go. I don't think that's going to feed everyone everything. Like your business is still necessary, but it is true. Like realistically, unless you're subsidized by the government or something, how are you going to make a profit and be able to serve someone who can't afford?
Yeah, well, that's also something to bring up is like, why can't the government be supporting programs like that or program, even though we're a business, like we could be doing so much more if the government was supporting us in some kind of way.
But you know, it's not going to happen until people demand it.
No, I know. I mean, I don't think it's going to happen. I'm just saying it would be nice.
Well, you never know. I mean, you never know. I never thought the Berlin Wall would come down, which is so long ago now, but I was showing my age. I went there when the wall was still up, and I just remember seeing these protesters camping at the Brandenburg Gate. Yeah, and they're like there till the wall came down. I'm like, that wall's never coming down. And learn my lesson.
I mean, I gotta say, like every time I talk to a politician, every time I've been in City Hall doing something, I'm always like, by the way.
No, and that's what you do.
What you guys should do.
But we also, and I'm sure you know this, you need to get your customers to call the offices because it only takes a few people. Like I'm not that politically involved. I vote, I'm aware, I'll march, but I'm not like on the phone every day. But if I get really pissed off, I just call because like 5 phone calls and they'll start to pay attention. That's but true. Anyway.
Oh, so, you know, one thing we're working on right now that we could use the community's help on. We want to launch a couple, we've been donating food to community fridges throughout like Brooklyn and Queens. We would love to
you got to explain what it is because I think they're brilliant. There's one on the Lower East Side. So I put a group together in the East Village called East Village Neighbors to help when COVID hit. So there's a community fridge that just launched the Lower East Side. Explain what it is because this is with Planning Chair. It's like the Planning Chair ethos.
Yeah. I mean, the community fridge is essentially, it's a fridge that's locked up. That's, you know, it's locked to something on the sidewalk in some neighborhood. And pretty much anyone that needs food can take something out of the refrigerator. People have been donating food so that the fridges are packed with good stuff. So we've been donating, you know, like our organic veggies and some other stuff to some fridges. And
but I just want to clarify. I just want to clarify for people. It's literally a refrigerator that is parked out. Yeah, it's parked outside a building, and then there's just all you need is a power switch. You need a plug somewhere.
Yeah. So we're just looking, we want to have a couple of our own community fridges in different areas. So want to help us like start that initiative, if it just means like helping us find a free fridge or a business where we can plug into and sit outside their place, let us know, because that's something we really want to have a large impact on.
I might know a community center in my area. I'm writing it down. Okay. I will contact them just to see if they might be interested, because I think that's a brilliant idea. Because what I have found with the group I have is, especially now with PUA, the federal insurance being gone, I mean, people are hungry. The city has gotten so much better. So I'm not dissing the city. At the beginning, people like us were really, really necessary. But there's this gap between when SNAP is coming or just now, people just don't have enough money. So they want fresh food. You know, they want whole food they can cook. They don't want the processed stuff that a lot of people get.
Exactly. Yeah, because there's so many food pantries. Obviously, are getting things that are canned items, but we want to make sure that the fresh stuff can be out there. And, you know, so like I read an article that I don't know how much this is happening in New York City, but like restaurant workers that haven't been able to get work again, many of them are going to pantries to get, you know, to help with their expenses. So I'm hoping that this can also help that community of people, because obviously we want to take care of other people in the food industry. Right. And it also is another way for us to make local organic stuff accessible to more people.
Right. Okay. So this is a question I'm asking every guest that I have. I'm going to put a montage together at some point. But what do we need to do to create a food system where everyone can eat healthy food, which ties into the discussion we're having right now?
Diane, that's literally the hardest question. I'm pretty sure you emailed me this question ahead of time and I did not plan ahead for it. Yeah, sorry. So
that's okay. But I gave you warning.
We need to have definitely more farms we also need the government to help subsidize these platforms. Just the infrastructure, I think, in general of food needs to have more resources and be better. There needs to be more trucking options to get food from the farm to the city, which people don't realize is a huge, huge problem, which also makes things really expensive. We need the city and the state support for initiatives to bring more food from regional farms into the city or into anywhere. We should probably be taxing. I think we should be taxing companies that are creating food that we know is bad for your health and use that money to help subsidize new farms. Because, you know, like farmers, we're not going to have new young farmers if they don't think they can make a living off of it. So yeah, that's my idea.
It's a great idea. And I'm not going to get negative. It's great. We can do it. We can tax the big food companies. Hey, you know what? I mean, people talked about a sugar tax. And I remember people being laughed at. And it's being taken more seriously now. So, yeah. And again, the Berlin Wall came down.
But also, you told me an ideal vision.
Yes. No.
An ideal vision that's also realistic.
Well, I don't care. I actually don't care about realistic, because an idea can become real. That's you just true. Have to have the motivation and the passion, you know, and word just has to get out. So what I'm sort of hoping by asking everyone this is that something will form, a vision itself will form within each person's vision to create something that I can actually push with Change Food.
Yeah.
So what do you think, like, you know, just on a, like a personal living in this, the neighborhood I live in New York City for 25 years, it just so much has changed. So what do you think might happen with farms and farm businesses with the effects? Like, we haven't hit the depression yet. You know, we're still in the height of the first wave of the pandemic, but are you concerned? Like, do you have any idea what you think might happen?
Farms?
We'll start with farms and then businesses.
I think local farms, smaller farms are gonna thrive. I think the bigger farms are going to have a hard time. And the reason why for that, and I think sometimes people don't realize why industrial farms have a hard time during this time, is because a lot of those farmers are selling to institutions like on a large scale. And if those institutions aren't in operation, so say you talk about like universities or like anything like right. a big purchaser, right? Right? If they're not operating to the same capacity, they're not going to need to buy stuff from these larger farms, which means that these farmers don't know how to reach a retail, like a consumer, a direct consumer. It's also, so I definitely think the smaller farms would have this relationship to their direct consumer through, they started their own, like, you know, they're selling at farmers markets, they're selling through CSAs, they're selling to us, they're, some of them have even started like own like farm stands at their own farm. They've been able to create structures to have multiple revenue streams, which is really good.
Right.
And they're even set up, like, for example, like large egg producers. The reason why they had a hard time pivoting is like, they didn't even have like literally egg cartons, right? Because big egg producers sell things in flats.
Right.
And that's how their machines work. So to get machines to put eggs in egg cartons and to buy egg cartons and figure that whole thing out, it takes a lot. So I definitely think the small farms are going to thrive, which is awesome. I think in terms of businesses, you see a lot of businesses popping up now that are kind of doing what sort of we do, like farm boxes or grocery delivery services. I think it's great that people find that there's a peak in cooking at home now with consumers. I think a lot of those companies are bullshit, and it really breaks my heart that, like, I think a lot of companies are doing using greenwashing to get to consumers.
How can people tell? Because that's really important. Like, greenwashing is one of my biggest pet peeves. How can someone tell if there's a...
Yeah, I mean, I literally, like, I went through all the Instagram ads that I was getting, and I just compared their ad to their website and see how they sourced. That's something if someone wants to do, they can do. So what I would do is, like, you know, people that were saying they were sourcing things local or organic, I would go to their website, try to see a list of farms, look at their values about us. If they're not at all transparent, if you can't find farm names on there, that's bullshit. Right. If they say when local, we source local when possible, that's bullshit, because that means you can source locally once a year and say you're sourcing locally. I think you have to just dive a little into the website and not just like get excited about an Instagram ad.
And the so same, that's something. Go ahead.
No, it's just, it's a trend I've been seeing through the pandemic, and it really sucks because you're taking away like this beautiful movement of supporting local farms in a transparent way. Like, we're trying to make a difference, you know, like what we're doing, what farmers markets are doing, what direct CSAs are doing. And you're just making a business because you can see this financial gain from it, and you're lying to consumers. And then now you're going to confuse consumers to think, one, it's going to be a different price point. It's probably going to be cheaper than what other people can offer because it's not actually sourced responsibly. You're tapping into someone's like goodwill of like, oh, I'm buying something that's better for my body and better for the land, and it's not actually true. So I think all of it is a little annoying.
I found that surprisingly with farm stands. Like, my mother lives in Lower Delaware, and I was looking for a tomato a little bit before they were in season, and I saw them for sale, and I actually asked the farmers there, and they got them in North Carolina. I'm like, oh, you got a local farm.
Oh, no.
And there was one we went to, my mom said, oh, there's this new farmer's market. And we went, and it was a farm stand, but all the food, except for like cucumbers, were from other states. They were all not, it was not, yeah. It was like, you could have gone into your grocery store and bought the same stuff. So people have to really, I think what you said about researching, and that if you don't see a farm's name on the website, or they're not telling you the exact farm they're sourcing from, it's suspect. Because
I think the key is just like, don't make assumptions, right? Just because you're at a farm stand, don't just assume it's...
Well, I'm going to give this one to the consumer, because it used to be that way back when. Like, where I came from, you know, about this time of year, people put stuff out on the front lawn and put a sign that says free, or they put a jar, pay what you want, and it's tomatoes and cucumber, you just help yourself. So I do come from that. It was a shock. I mean, it was a shock when someone told me, I heard that New York is pretty strict about knowing that the farmers are selling their own stuff, but that there are farmers markets where the farmers are basically buying this stuff from a wholesaler. Mm-hmm. They're not really farmers.
I mean, I know of a farm that sells, that might still sell to a farmers market in New York City that did that a couple times. So I know that happened. It's a tricky business.
So, okay, we'll change subject. Your bio says your spirit vegetable is kumatsuma. I can't pronounce it. I just lost you again. How do you pronounce it and what is it?
It's komatsuna.
Komatsuma?
Komatsuna.
Okay.
And it is an Asian green that has like a big, bright green, sort of like flattish leaf. Well, it's a little spoon-like. And it tastes like a milder bok choy, and the stems are really juicy, kind of like almost like celery. So it's really good raw. It's also just good cooked. Yeah.
And why is that your spirit vegetable?
One, I like it because no one knows what it is. So there's some kind of like mystery around it.
Like you.
And I also like that it's mostly cooked in Japanese home cooking. It's not usually in fine dining, which I think is nice. It feels more cozy. And I like that it's so versatile. You know, I like that it can be eaten raw easily, that it can be cooked really easily. And it's also a really beautiful vegetable when you look at it.
I'm going to Google it. I didn't want to Google it to talk to you. I'm like, oh my God, I feel so bad. I don't know what this is. Okay, so something else. I saw somewhere you were described as combining first generation hustle with female intuition. So what do you get when you put that together? Bad question. That was an obvious answer.
Okay, so I would say that you get you get something that's different, because I am not really basing my decisions on like market research. I don't know how other businesses make decisions. I didn't go to business school, so I don't know. But what I base my decisions on is really just like what I feel inside is the right thing to do or the right path. And I'm always working my ass off, you know, to just make something happen. So we're very action oriented. Everyone on our team is very much like just trying to like wants to get things done, which I think is the reason why we've been able to do so much with such a small team.
Yeah, I just want to let you know I did go to business school, and all you do when you get out is unlearn what you learned in.
Yes, see, I just saved so much money by not going to business school.
Yeah. I think education is necessary. I think that what would be called a trade school is just as important and meaningful as a university, because a lot of universities putting stuff out and forgetting it. Universities are, I think, are best for contacts. I mean, you do learn something. I don't want to put down universities. I just found I did not want to be a business major.
And I got to say that my university was the best. My parents would want to know this. I just think maybe it helped with my social skills.
That's what I think it's important. That's it. It's networking. I think that is why everyone should go to some type of college, university, and that's what's really unfortunate with the pandemic right now is younger people, you know, it's really messed up.
I really just, when I say social skills, I really just partied a lot.
That is social skills. When you take the partying out, you still have the skills.
That's true.
So listen, we're going to wrap up now. Do you have any final words or anything? Words of wisdom. I'm going to put you on just you. Give us some words of wisdom.
Wait, words of wisdom around what though?
Life.
Life.
I want Wen-Jay's words of wisdom.
Okay, well, I will say that I'm a firm believer of you can do almost anything in life as long as you want it to happen. So I wanted a different kind of way to eat and buy food in New York City. So I literally just made my own business to have a different way to do that. I don't think my philosophy of business is actually just like keeping your head down and really focusing on what you think is right, because that's really what's going to make you unique. I think there's just too many temptations out there, shortcuts you can take as a business. A lot of people take them. Mm-hmm. And in the long run, like I'm thinking long-term. Like I want to know how can Local Roots stay in New York City till past my lifetime and make an impact for generations to come in the city and also the farmland around us.
So my decisions are really based on that, which is why like a values, having a strong value system, really loving our community is so important to me. Yeah, and I wholeheartedly believe that. I'm not just saying these things. It means everything to me. So if anyone who is watching is a customer of ours, I really, really appreciate all of that. Like every single person is really important to us. And we're super appreciative of our farmers. And this sounds like I'm like giving like a thank you speech. It's weird.
You're practicing for your Nobel Prize.
That's true.
Well, no, but you know what you just said when you started that, I'm really into spiritual stuff. It's the law of attraction. We create our own reality, and physicists mm-hmm. will actually, because I wanted to be an astrophysicist. I can't even say it right now. Yes. A physicist is a physicist. But girls didn't do math in the 70s, so I was booted out. But physics, spirituality, so yes, law of attraction. If you want it, you can create it. Yeah. And it doesn't have to be a lot of hard work, which I haven't figured that one out yet.
Oh, yeah, neither have I. There's something about our personality tests, I'm sure, it's attracted to hard work.
Yes. And there's nothing wrong with that. I just, you know, I want to slow down a little. I'm getting ready to reap the benefits, Wen-Jay.
I'm
riding on your coattails. But listen, thank you so much. And thanks to all of you for being here. Next week, we have Sanjay Raul. He's the director of a new film coming out called Gather. Wen-Jay, you're going to want to see this. It's about Native Americans taking back their food culture. I got to watch it. Yeah, he did this film called Food Chains a few years ago, which was fantastic. But this is really good because I think it's so important. Like Black Lives Matter, of course, it's like so important. Native Americans, we have to start giving them their due. Like they have been slaughtered, and there's a woman working on buffalo and the reintroducing buffalo back. Anyway, it's really interesting. I don't want to tell everyone until next week. Wen-Jay, thank you. Love
you. Thank you, Diane.
Miss you. Hope to see you again soon. Bye.